Praise the Lord. It is another Sunday, and we have another message for you and some songs as well. So let us get started with prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all of your goodness and how you continue to take care of us each and every day. Lord, as we are going to share your word and as we take the time to worship, we ask, Lord, that you would just bless. May you multiply, dear Lord, your blessings, and may, dear Lord God, that strength go out to each and every one that tunes in and watches or listens to this particular message. We thank you, Father, that you are with us. Lord God, that we can have that joy and know, dear Lord Jesus, that you are taking care of everything. Thank you, Lord, for just giving us that gift that we can put our trust in you. So now, Lord, we ask for your blessing. May you multiply in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's begin once again with some songs and choruses. And we are going to start with Hallelujah Anyhow.
I'll be satisfied. Thank you.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everyone. Hold on. That's a great song with a great, great message. Well, you may have had the pleasure of waking up at some point this past week, opening up your blinds, having a look out the window to see what? In May, today is May the 10th, in May, what did we see outside? Snow. Some snow. Yes, as you looked out the window and you perhaps scanned over your garden, whether that be, well, vegetables would be a little early, but looking out over some of those hardy flowers, they may not have looked too happy. And perhaps as you looked out of the window, you weren't too happy either. However, my window is not necessarily your window. And we have to keep in mind that what I saw out of my window is not necessarily what others saw out of their window. What may they have seen? Well, in some areas, they may have seen more snow. Yes, there were places that received more snow than we receive. Other parts of the country and other places may have seen flooding, streets covered with water, needing to wade through at hip height or even higher, all belongings washed away. In Kenya right now, they're struggling with locusts, swarms and swarms of locusts. So as they look out their window, clouds, literally clouds of locusts coming to devour entire crops. And the people doing everything they can, getting out there to try and keep them off of those crops. While some people saw flooding, there are other areas where people may have looked out of their window and seen drought. Where there once was a river, where there once was a lake, now nothing but mud bottom that is all drying out. Still others, looking out their window, may have seen forest fires. Fires raging, burning everything in sight, coming ever, ever closer to homes. Then, of course, we just have general, and I say that not saying that it's small, storm damage. Could have been hurricanes, tornadoes, high winds, and the damage that that does. That's what some people may have seen looking out their window. In other parts of the world, perhaps people opened their windows and saw protests. Some of those protests violent, as people are upset and clashing with one another and sometimes clashing with authorities. And of course, in the time that we're living in right now with this virus and the damage that that is doing in society in many, many different ways, unfortunately, some people open their windows to see death. No, I'm not trying to depress you. And I'm certainly not trying to do a weather forecast or news broadcast of any sort. We're actually going to take a look at how we as God's people need to be different from the world. And that, of course, is a theme that we can apply to many different aspects of our lives, because we are supposed to be different. But I wanted to take a look at, and the chorus we started off with this message, Hallelujah Anyhow. Now I have to confess, I opened up the window and I saw that snow, just a little bit of snow, it wasn't too much. And was I thrilled about that? No, actually, that snow had an impact on my emotions. It made me feel kind of downhearted. I wasn't really happy about it. I remember groaning a little bit and not being very happy. I guess I was sort of like one of those flowers, bent over, drooped over, because the snow had an impact on me naturally. But as God's people, we are to be different, and we can come to the Lord and we can gain the power, overcoming power, so that we, at the very least, do not stay drooped over. It would be much better if we don't droop over at all. Because as Christians, our strength, our joy, who we are, what we are, does not come from the natural things that are around us. Now, you may be sitting somewhere watching this and thinking, oh, but Pastor Roger, you don't know my situation. And you are right. I don't know your situation. And that's why I listed off some other sort of things people might be seeing as they open up their window. The list goes on and on and on, because not only could it be a natural window that we're opening up, but just the fact that we're opening our eyes to another day. And everyone's day holds something different. No question. The same is true for all of God's people. Every one of our natural days holds something different. However, as one of God's children, we have something that the world does not have. We have someone that the world does not have, and that is to make a difference in your life, in mine, regardless of what we face as we open up our eyes or we pull back the blinds and we look out the window. Let's have a look at Scripture. There are many, 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 and I emphasize that, many Scriptures that speak to the difference between you and I, God's people, and the world, and all of them therefore also address an aspect of how we deal with those situations differently than the world does. And this is really, really important, because part of this is our testimony. Part of this is what the world sees and should see each and every day. They should see a difference. They recognize that we're living in the same place. They recognize that we are going through the same challenge. What they also need to see and recognize is that we're not doing it the way the majority are doing it. We are to face those things and deal with those things God's way, as God's children. So I tried, and you know, sometimes it's very difficult, I tried to limit the verses, and I'm probably going to cut down what I have selected, even from the many that I picked out. They're all very powerful, and perhaps I'll give them to you just so that you can write them down and look at them yourself. I've got 12, and they touch on three sort of different areas. And again, we may not get to all of them. And if I don't have the time or I feel it's not necessary right now to touch on every one of them, I will let you know what they are, the ones that I had written down. So we're going to begin, and I always like to establish fact. Fact not in my mind, but fact in God's Word. And so when I say to you, we are to be different, you might say, well, that's just your opinion. No, I don't want it to be just my opinion. I need it to be what the Word of God tells me. So, first section, area that we want to establish is that we are to be different. John chapter 15 is where we are going to begin. John chapter 15, verse 19. I'm just picking out one verse here. It says, Jesus is speaking here, and he says, if ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. So there is absolutely no better authority than God himself, than Jesus himself. And Jesus himself says here that we are not, he says, because ye are not of the world. We're in it. Yes. At the moment, we are all in the world. That means that these natural things that are going on around us do also include us. but we are not of it. That means we are different. That means that we are to have a different attitude, a different approach, a different response. You name it, it is all to be different than what the world has as far as their standard and the way that they do things. We follow God's way. Okay? And of course, and we find this somewhat, I think, challenging at times, it means that therefore the world hateth you. The world doesn't like different. As much as people, you know, say, oh, I want to be different, I want to be unique, you find very quickly that uniqueness is actually something that everybody's doing. And as God's people, we want to be different in the way we do things. Like I said, we do things God's way. So Jesus himself says that we are not of the world. Isaiah chapter 55, to just reinforce that particular verse that we just read, Isaiah 55, two verses here, verses 8 and 9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Now this is a very, very good thing. It means that God is ultimately different than anyone and everything else. And he is different in the best way. So as natural human beings, we recognize our tendencies. You know, like I said, when I opened up the curtain, saw a little bit of snow. Oh, I thought, how terrible is this? And I was listening to the forecast, and here in Cambridge, where we are tomorrow, oh, I'm praying the weather person would be incorrect. We're supposed to get 2 centimeters of snow. 2 centimeters of snow on May the 11th. Well, if that happens, what kind of attitude should I have? Should it be all gloomy and despair? It needs to be something different. So God's thoughts are not ours, and we strive, we look to him as our example. And that is, of course, what we want to be as Jesus is. Now, I want to give you one more verse in this area, and it's in Job. It's an interesting verse, and one that I think I'll study some more, and I would ask you to meditate on this a little bit, because Job says in chapter 6, Job chapter 6, he says in verse 12, Job 6 and 12, is my strength the strength of stones, or is my flesh of brass? Both of these are questions that Job is asking. And I would just suggest to you, what Job is really saying here is, you know, stones are strong. Stones are natural. So is brass that he speaks of there. And really, I think what Job is suggesting here as he asks this question is, are we getting our strength from something that is natural, like a stone? Or does our strength as God's people come from somewhere, someone else? What about our flesh, our life? Is our life like natural brass? It's strong. But is our life something more than that? And Job, you see, I believe, is saying to us, it needs to be. It needs to be, because stone can be broken, stone can be crushed, and brass can be melted and beaten and dented and all of these different things. Is that God's people? Are we to be like a stone that can be crushed like brass? No, I don't believe that we are. We are to be more. And that is not in ourselves, but that is from our Lord. So let's turn now to a number of verses. You'll notice I'm moving through the verses fairly quickly. They're fairly self-explanatory. They are confirmation, I believe, to how we are to be different and suggest to us that we are to be those people, God's people, that do sing that chorus, hallelujah, anyhow. That regardless of the snow, the fire, the tornado, the locust, all of these things, not great. The virus, whatever it happens to be, we are not downhearted, but we sing hallelujah anyhow because our strength comes from a different source. Our strength, our joy, comes not from the things that we see around us, but comes from one who is eternal and one who can provide regardless of the situation. Nehemiah chapter 8. And here I have a number of verses. A few of them are actually all very close together, so we'll journey through these together, all confirming what I've just said, because it's God's word. And we grab a hold of it, and we don't let go. Nehemiah chapter 8 and verse 10. Then he said unto them, go your way, eat the fat, and drink the sweet, and send portions unto them for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy unto our Lord. Neither be ye sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Neither be ye sorry. Don't be sad. Why? Because we're so amazing? Because we can overlook situations? No. Because the joy of the Lord is your strength, is my strength. And of course, we have that chorus. The joy of the Lord is my strength. And here in Nehemiah, that's what Scripture is telling us. So I've now found, and we're going to turn to, a number of verses that all confirm that the Lord is our strength. The Lord is our salvation, the Scripture will often say. And this all confirming it is not coming from ourselves, but comes from God. Turn with me now to Psalm, and we're going to look at a few verses in Psalm. Psalm 118 is where we begin. I suppose I could have put these in order for you, but I didn't. So we're going to flip around a little bit here in Psalm. Psalm 118, verse 14. The Lord is my strength and song, and has become my salvation. And I always like to give you multiple verses because one of these is bound to stick. And one of these is, I pray, going to help you through that tough time. The Lord is my strength and song, and has become my salvation. Psalm 18. I have an advantage. I have marked these earlier in my Bible. Psalm 18, verse 2. We know this one. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation and my high tower. In other words, God provides all of these things. Notice, none of these verses talk about it only happens in certain situations. God does not say that he will be my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, my strength, my buckler, the horn of my salvation, my high tower. God doesn't say, I'm only going to do that for you on sunny days. He doesn't say, I'm only going to do that for you when everything is going well. No. All the time, God is able to do it all. We have to remember that. Okay? And I know it's difficult because, again, we're humans. We're natural. You know, we feel these things, and the enemy comes in, and I believe Satan puts in fear and doubt, and we tremble. But let's remember, God said he is all of these things for us. Psalm 27. Psalm 27, the first verse, verse 1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Question. Remember that one. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Not only of whom, but of what? See, there is nothing If we have that joy and recognize God is our strength, God is the one that will help me through this, then we don't have to fear. We don't have to tremble. Wisdom, sure, lots of wisdom. God gives us that. But these things that would cause us to be so terrified that we can't do anything and hang our heads low, no. No, we don't need to do that as God's people. Of whom shall I be afraid? Whom shall I fear? Now to Proverbs. And we're traveling through these verses rather nicely, so I'm just going to keep going. Proverbs chapter 10. Proverbs 10. Verse 29. The way of the Lord is strength to the upright, but destruction shall be to the workers of iniquity. The way of the Lord is strength. So you see, as one of God's children, if you are saved, if you have been born again, if you are now walking in the way of the Lord, striving to do what God has asked us to do, to live the way God has asked us to do, God says the way of the Lord is strength to the upright. See, God then is there to help us regardless of the situation. The verse also speaks of the opposite. If you choose not to do something the way God says we need to do it, what's going to be the outcome? Destruction. Nobody wants destruction. Let's strive for the strength that God can give us. Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 12. Verse 2, Isaiah 12 and 2. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He also is become my salvation. Similar thoughts. They all have a similar thought, adding one to the other. Speaks about having a song. I like to whistle. Often do that without thinking. Certainly when I was in my previous profession as a school teacher and administrator, I would always be told that I was walking down the halls whistling. They knew when I was coming because I'd be whistling. I don't even know if it was a particular tune, but I would be whistling. And generally speaking, you tell me, when you hear somebody whistling or they are singing a song, happy or sad? Well, a whistle tends to be associated with joy, tends to be associated with a happy spirit. And I praise and thank the Lord that He has given me a happy spirit. Not all the time. You remember, I'm human. And so there are times when, yes, I do get down. But I then need to do what I'm telling you, you need to do. We all need to do this. We need to remember the promises that the Lord has given us. I will trust and not be afraid. Let's just close with a couple of verses. I want you to think once again to the view out the window. You see, the view out the window, when I looked out and I saw all the snow, maybe you saw lots of snow, or whatever situation is in your life right now. God did not promise us that He would always or immediately change the view. I opened up the blinds, I looked out, I saw the snow. Had I prayed, "Oh Heavenly Father, send warmth, send sunshine," He could. He didn't. The view remained the same. You see, God says that you're in the world. You're not of the world. And in this world, there are going to be some tough days. There might be some tough weeks. There might be some tough years. Life might be tough. God does not promise to always or immediately change the view. But He says that I can give you something so that you will deal with that situation in a positive way, in a joyful way, in a way that magnifies the Lord who gives us the strength to do so. John chapter 16. I've got three more verses for you. John chapter 16, verse 33. See, this is very, very important because non-believers will sometimes question, well, often question. One of the things that they might tend to do is say, well, you know, if God loves us so much, then why does he do this and why does he do that? You see, that is a sort of a question that suggests that God has to make everything wonderful all the time. And that's not what God promised. But God did promise. What does he say in verse 33? These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. You see, our God is the ultimate overcomer. He is the one who absolutely is not impacted by any of these situations. None. It doesn't get him down. It doesn't cause God to lose hope. God doesn't lose faith. God doesn't suddenly not trust. No, none of these things move him. He is the ultimate overcomer. And as Jesus said, I have overcome the world. Now, as one of God's children, I think it was the Sunday school lesson this morning, we were talking about children of promise. Promise that we have an inheritance. We are heirs. If God has overcome, if Jesus has overcome, he says to us, we can have peace. He says to us that the world's going to have tribulation, but we are to be of good cheer. Wow. In other words, I open up the window tomorrow morning, May the 11th, 2020, 2 centimeters of snow on the ground. Be of good cheer, Pastor Roger. Easy to say. Only with God's help is that possible. So if you hear me cheering, praise the Lord, there's snow on the ground. Which would be an odd thing for me to say since I really don't like the winter. That would be only God's doing, because in my natural self, my tendency will be to want to just close the blinds again and forget about what is out there. But God also said, and really doesn't say, he doesn't say, oh, just close the blinds and forget what's going on out there. We have to recognize those things are real. It's how we deal with them. Two verses now in closing in 1 John. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4. 1 John 4 and 4. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Another chorus we sing. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. That's a wonderful promise and something, again, for each and every one of us. What a blessing to know that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. One more verse. Just over the page in my Bible, 1 John chapter 5. Verse 4. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. God, the victor over everything, including death, says to you and I that we can also be overcomers. So as you travel through this world and as we face each and every day that the Lord allows us and gives us the blessing to face. Let us remember that regardless of what we see, regardless of what news we receive, that we can have the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. That we have the privilege of tapping into that oil of gladness that knows no end. The problem comes to you and to me when we restrict the flow of that joy, when we separate ourselves from God. And so we need to hold fast, and we need to grab a hold of the Lord, and we need to grab a hold of His promises and recognize, my God can do anything. He is an overcomer, and He can give us the strength so that we can face that trial or that test with good cheer, as the scripture tells us, and have that joy in our soul, not within ourselves, from ourselves, but from the Lord. Let's pray. Hallelujah. Praise you, dear Lord Jesus, for your word, which is so powerful, which is such a blessing, which is such an encouragement, dear Lord Jesus, to us, your people. What I love to think about, Lord, is that when I open up the curtain, when I open up my eyes and I face a day, when I open up the curtain and I look out the window, I do not do that alone. Lord, you are there with your children. You are standing there with us as we look out the window. You are there with us as we receive the news that is perhaps not very good. You are there with us. And so, dear Lord Jesus, we are not alone in that trial, in that test. But we can have the peace, we can have the rest, we can have the joy, the cheerfulness, because it flows from you into us, your children, as part of the inheritance, as part of what we receive as being in your family. And I just pray, dear Lord God, that right now, regardless of the situation that my brother or my sister may be facing, and there are many trials and many tests that each and every one is dealing with right now, today. Lord God, if it's financial, if it's emotional, if it is, dear Lord Jesus, a health concern, whatever it may happen to be, if it's a spiritual need, Father, we thank you that you are able to provide. And we claim the peace. We claim the rest. And we claim the joy. And we are able to pray one for another. And so, Lord, I thank you that I have brothers and sisters in the Lord, part of the family. They're out there, I believe, praying for me. And Lord, I ask, Lord, that you would help them to feel that I am praying for them. Dear Lord Jesus, be with us as this week unfolds. May we, dear Lord God, continue to be that testimony for you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. For the joy of the Lord is my strength. And therefore, I can sing hallelujah anyhow. Amen.